Good morning. Let us begin our prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to your hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have built your church upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Grant us so to be joined together in unity of spirit by their teaching, that we may be a holy temple acceptable to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. God did not make death, and he does not delight in the death of the living, for he created all things so that they might exist. The generative forces of the world are wholesome, and there is no destructive poison in them. And the dominion of Hades is not on earth, for righteousness is immortal. God created us for incorruption and made us in the image of his own eternity. But through the devil's enemy, death entered the world, and those who belong to his company experience it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 30 will be read respectively by half verse. I will exalt you, O Lord, because you have lifted me up.
And have lifted up.
O Lord, my God, I cried out to you.
And
you brought me up, O Lord, from the dead. Sing to the Lord, your servants of this.
Give thanks to the remembrance of his.
For his wrath endures but the twinkling of an eye.
His favor for the lifetime.
Weeping may spend the night.
But
while I felt secure, I said, I shall never be disturbed.
You, Lord, with your favor, made me strong his cross in the house.
Then you hid your face.
And I was filled with fear.
I cried to you, O Lord.
I forgave the Lord's season.
What profit is there in my blood if I go down to the pit?
Will the dust praise you, like your faithfulness?
Hear, O Lord, and have mercy upon me.
O Lord,
You have turned my wailing into dancing. Therefore, my heart swims to you without ceasing. A reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. As you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in our love for you, so we want you to excel also in the generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I am testing the genuineness of your love against the earnestness of others. Do you know the generous acts of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for our sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich? And in this matter, I am giving my advice. It is appropriate for you who began last year, not only to do something, but even desire to do something, now finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it according to your needs. For if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of a fair balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need, in order that there may be fair balance. As it is written, the one who had much did not have too much to do, and the one who had little did not have too little. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. One of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him, and a great crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, for she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately, her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people from the leader's house came and said, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except for Peter, James, and his brother John. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping. And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went into where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, Talitha kum, which means little girl, get up. And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In today's gospel, we have two very different people, yet the same. Jairus, we have to remember that the leaders of the religious leaders in general, but the leaders of the synagogue and the temple, had an adversarial relationship with Jesus. There was that contention. So that is a part of this mix. Jairus, by all counts, is someone who had money, he had power, and he had an easy life. And he could very well have sent a servant or someone else to Jesus and have him come and take care of his daughter. Yet this person, very much contrary to who and what he was in society and the way he was accustomed to living, comes to Jesus through a crowd. And again, this is not something he would do. If he was walking through the crowd, most likely that people, you know, opening up the way for him and stuff. But yet he comes amongst the people through the crowd and he comes to Jesus and he falls down at Jesus's feet and he begs him. It's probably the first time in his life this man has ever begged for anything, not something he was accustomed to. Yet, this is important, he had to do it himself. He felt he was compelled and he had to go and see Jesus, and that really is the key. His daughter was dying. Then you have the woman. The woman in this gospel doesn't even get a name. And she overcame an awful lot of obstacles to come to Jesus. And it's important, if we are really to get a sense of the significance and the depth of this gospel, it's not enough to intellectually understand. We have to really place ourselves in the shoes and in the lives of those people involved, Jairus, the woman. But back to the woman. Her health was poor. She was considered ritually, socially unclean. And she was poor. And she had no one to bring her to Jesus. Yet she doesn't sit around and wait to be taken care of. Another important reality in being a person of faith. There were a lot of obstacles between herself and Christ. Not that God put them there. There were social boundaries. She was a woman. She was a woman in that area of the world where she should not have been pushing through the crowd. It's incredibly, incredibly inappropriate for the social conditions of the time. She was a second-class citizen compared to the males. And what's more is because of her illness, she was impure. She was ritualistically unclean. Just like a leper having leprosy. Not that she had a communicable disease, but she should not and was forbidden from being around other people. And I'm sure in a small place, or even if it was a larger place, people would have known her and known her condition. She had it for 12 years. So there are other boundaries there. Others, people who would be in her way because of the old ways of seeing things. because of their self-serving interests and because of their arrogance. Yet she, like Jairus, she had to do it herself. She had to come to Jesus. And what does Jesus say throughout the whole thing? Your faith has cured you. Not a little statement, not insignificant. Your faith has cured you. Now, to get back to the story, if we read the flow of the story, I purposely, because Jairus comes first in the story, and then comes the woman. Imagine if you were Jairus, and your daughter was dying. She was dying. And all of a sudden, you're on the way, and Jesus is going to arrive, and Jesus is going to be there, but wait, everything stops because of the goings-on with this woman. Do you think you might just have a little bit of anxiety? You don't get this. My daughter is dying, and yet this woman comes up, and I don't know what's going on, but what do you hear from Jairus? Nothing. He doesn't say a word. Wow. I don't know about you. Is my daughter dying? What do you say? You cut in line. Remember that when we were kids? You know, you'd be waiting for the restroom or you'd be waiting to go to lunch. You cut in line. You know, we make a big thing of that. Well, if anybody had a reason to make a big thing of getting cut in line or things not being taken in the right order, it would have been him. But he doesn't say a word. And you got to imagine a person of his prestige and power is quite used to telling people what things should be. But he doesn't. And even when at the end of all that thing with this woman, people from his household come and say, your daughter is dead. He doesn't go after the woman and say, listen, if it weren't for you, she may still be alive. These are feelings that are quite, you know, understandable. But he does not. He remains in faith. And even Jesus then says to him, you know, what's needed is faith, not fear. So Jesus affirms him in his position and in his the way things are. He remains in faith even though things got really dark and really, really sad and tragic. So they get to the house, and understandably at the death of anyone, let alone a child of 12 years, there's quite sadness and just emotion. And Jesus sets this aside, and he goes in. And she was gone. She was dead. But if we look at this and say, well, Jesus just raised a 12-year-old girl from the dead, we don't get the full picture. Not that that's not important. It's incredible. Through the faith of Jairus, Jesus comes to this house, and he raises this young girl. But there's a deeper meaning there. It really is a good story, and I don't mean this to say it's not true, but I'm saying it's a good story to hear. It's happened 2,000 years ago. Well, that's nice. What's it mean in 2024? It is incredibly significant as we hear the invitation of the gospel to understand the fact that Jesus, yes, does have power over life and death. Very important, and I'm not minimalizing that at all. But maybe a lot of us are not facing those situations right now. And so what does this action of Jesus Christ mean through faith for us also? It's an edifying story, to be sure. What things in our lives may have died that could be restored to life? Relationships, joy, excitement, openness. Here's a good one. Patience. I always emphasize the ones that are my challenges. Patience. But there's so many. That the power of God through the door that is open with faith can do incredible things. And not just things that are, oh, that's kind of nice, ooh, ah. But things that really are at the heart of what it means to live in the family and be a part of the family of God. So a good question then, as we kind of look maybe a little towards us a little bit, is when are we not seeking God's help? How are we living our life of faith day to day? Unfortunately, sometimes we have to wait, or we do wait, until there's an emergency. There aren't any atheists in foxholes, they say. So in the midst of trauma and calamity and crisis, we turn to God, but how are we living day to day? Because you know what? This woman did not live her daily life as a faithless woman and just decide to get up one day and seek out Jesus to get her cure. Nor did Jairus live a life that was faithless either. That even in the midst of the tragedy that he hears, he still has faith in God because it isn't over. Because Jesus didn't say that it was over. How many of us would have still walked with him and you know, I mean, we just kind of grasp it in straws, but he, again, remains silent. He remains in faith. So both of these two people had humility. Both of them knew where to go to God. And certainly both had faith. They're very different. But then again, maybe they're not. Not where it counts. Humility. Humility. There's a word that takes a beating today, isn't it? Humility. Humility isn't self-debasement. It's not, I'm such a horrible person. Humility is putting God first and setting ourselves aside. Putting God first. Jairus falls at the feet of Jesus. The woman faces social rejection. Just to touch his clothing. I'm not going to bother the guy. I just want to touch his clothing because that'll be enough. And how does Jesus respond to this woman who touched his clothes? Say, woman, God's her daughter. Think of the rejection she had from society, but the acceptance and recognition she had from Jesus Christ. Daughter. Not just some other person. Child of God. So then the question comes back to us. Faith is an island of peace without fear. Within. We need to open the door and open the door wider in humility and in faith. Opening that door becomes a source of healing. If we think about the way we treat other people and look in society, and again, we can look to ourselves because it's probably the better place, but aren't there just so many examples? There are people who get shot because they may have not let somebody on the highway or cut somebody off accidentally or something. How ridiculous. The extremes that we go to as a people. Open the door. Don't fear, only believe is what Jesus invites us, as he says to Jairus. Faith opened the door wider to the power of God. Are we living by faith? And are we consciously, as we're invited to today, opening that door wider? Because we've seen in this gospel what comes of that. Incredible things. The obstacles that we put in the way of God need to be removed. Arrogance, self-serving attitudes, lying, manipulation, all those bad things. Tom, there's a whole bunch of bad things we could say. But those obstacles are the obstacles we place and close the door to the faith of the things that we really need and want and God wants so much to give us. But we can close ourselves off to that. And so Jairus and this woman stand as a great example. Think about that woman's condition for a moment. Physically and socially, 12 years. What's it like to suffer for 12 years? What's it like to have a child who's seriously ill? I pray that you will never know that, but some do. And if we don't, personally, we know someone who does. And so really that comes back to having faith and humility enough to be compassionate. You're old enough to remember when the AIDS epidemic broke out, late 70s, early 80s, horrible and reprehensible things that were said to people who suffered and died from that disease. And it doesn't just have to limit itself to that. Think about the way we treat people with issues of mental health, people whose lifestyles are different, people who are poor, people of different ethnicities. This can keep on going. If compassion is not the first thing we feel when we encounter human suffering, we really need to open that door greater to faith. And our world needs it, our society needs it so, so badly. And it's got to come from within. Why is it that Jairus hears about the death of his daughter and he still follows? It was over in the eyes of the world, not in the eyes of faith. What can happen if our faith grows? Great question. And that's exactly what the gospel is challenging us to hear today. What can happen? Compassion and care of others, and not judgment. We must have humility. We must have faith. And certainly then, love. That's who we are. Today, Jesus invites us to open our hearts and our souls wide. May God be blessed. I invite you at this time to stand if you wish and let us profess our faith. We believe in one God.
Father, be almighty. May every heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen, may the vision of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God,
through him all things were destined for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Suffered death, was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. And his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. And the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Jesus is the chief cornerstone of the church. Inspire the church to proclaim the resurrection throughout the world. May it make Jesus the center of its commitment while instilling your love in the hearts of your people. Gracious God, hear our prayer. Unite the leaders of the world in the quest for peace and cooperation. Bless those who strive for justice and equality. Lead them to solve the conflict in the Middle East and Ukraine. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Ignite the hearts of this nation's representatives to ensure freedom to all your people. May they bring glory to your name as the chief cornerstone of their activities in preserving free and fair elections. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
As we celebrate Independence Day, may we be thankful for freedom from tyranny. Moreover, give us a strong faith to believe that we most value freedom is the victory over sin through Christ. Gracious God, bless the armed forces at home and abroad with zeal to protect our freedoms. Bring them home safely to their loved ones. Gracious God, help us to never forget the hungry and homeless with gifts of food and dwellings. Gracious God, give faith to the bereaved, the lonely, and the distressed. Gracious God, restore good mental, physical, and spiritual health to the infirm, and guide the dying into peace and eternal joy in the resurrection. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
I also invite you to pray for and remember in your prayers Penelope, who was born this past week, Penelope Muth. We pray for her in joy, for her birth and her health and for her family. We also pray for Mary Rose, Jean, Joan, Bob, Greg, and Sally. Gracious God, Lord, keep us in your love, preserve our community, and do not let us become separated from one another. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most of us,
Lord, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed,
by what we have done,
and by what we have left undone. We have
loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
I appeal to you, sisters and brothers, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship.
A song of thanksgiving, the God of the free, trying to deliver the compassion that made us and protected us. His banners far over us, his light goes deep around us. A billion fire shining for in the night, which shadows have vanished, when darkness is banished, a small word we can try, and light is flooding.
Dream.
And a song that loves me will all be sound in dying thanksgiving. God in the mind, oh, there I am. We too should be voicing our love and rejoicing with pride and adoration, a song that loves fame. We're all this mountain, not in the hearts, not in the hearts, oh,
all things come of thee, O Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, 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 holy.
We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, and the calling of Israel to be your people, and your words spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the Word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin, into righteousness, out of death, into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father,
we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Amen.
Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. And together with our sisters and brothers who join us virtually and do not receive communion under physical form, but certainly make a spiritual communion, we pray together our prayer of St. Alphonsus. My Jesus, I believe that you are present on the most holy Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I can be come at least spiritually into my life. I embrace you, if you will be. I mean, myself, owe to you, never permit me to be separated from me. Let us pray. Eternal God,
you have received us as the living members
of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ,
and you have led us spiritually moving to sacrifice the body and the blood, to send us down to the world in peace,
and bring us strength and courage
to follow and serve you. That is the singleness of heart.
Christ our Lord. Amen.
May the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
To explain to our virtual congregation why I keep twisting the cameras and they probably need to take Dramamine. They changed the program this morning, so I only have the one camera working, so I apologize. But that's technology. The other technology problem I had is the Muth sent me a picture of their baby in color, and it's beautiful. And I couldn't print it in color, so I apologize. But there's a copy out on the bulletin board. And when she comes here, certainly we'll welcome Penelope and be very happy for Paul and Karen and Calvin, and just really such a special and blessed occasion. So congratulations. And we give thanks to God and pray for them, of course. I'd like to thank all the people who were involved with the picnic this year. I think it was probably the best one they've ever put on. A lot of good and wonderful effort went into preparing, cleaning, cooking, all that stuff, planning, the setup, the basket raffle that we had.
the painting of the rocks, which was, that was pretty cool. And the bingo, and then we even had dancing, which was pretty neat. And thankfully I did not participate in that. That would have been a mess. But it was a great time. And for all the people who cleaned up and helped with the service, I mean, it was such a great effort by so many of you, and thank you. It was a great picnic. And I think there was the spirit-led wisdom last year or the year before when we decided to be here and use our property, because especially with the heat and the humidity, people had the opportunity to be inside and attend as well as outside if they should have chosen to do so. So it was and plus we have just a wonderful place to have a picnic. So it was a great day. And thank you to all who participated and worked on it and made it such a wonderful occasion. The other thing I'd like to make you aware of, if you're not, is if you remember, I think it was around 2014, about 2018, the bishop who had come and provided interim leadership for us after Bishop Paul retired and before we elected Bishop Kevin was Bishop Sean Rowe. He was our bishop provisional for, I think it was about 4 years. He has been elected to be presiding bishop, which is of the, you know, over the whole church. And he, with the House of Bishops and of course all the different committees and groups, help guide and lead the church, lay and clergy both. But if you could keep Bishop Sean in your prayers, give thanks to God for when he was here, he really was a great blessing to our diocese, as I'm sure he will be to the Episcopal Church at large. So just a little news if you're not aware of that, but good man. And do we have gift cards? And we have the hat too. You have the hat?
Hats on, yeah. I'll put a couple.
Okay. All right. The hat makes the outfit, but anyway. And also just in case the trays that we use today, John donated. So thank you very much. Instead of the little cafeteria trays, we now have something a lot nicer to put the Eucharist and distribute it on. So anything else? All right, let us go forth in the name of Christ.
I'm going to
And then she thinks out we have a chair. You know,
Hello, though, Missy Ann. How are you?
Yeah, I didn't bring the chair.
It's okay.